Welcome to Scania's press and web conference for the presentation of the first quarter of 2014. Jan Ytterberg, CFO, will in a moment run through the financial details of the quarter. But first, CEO Martin Lundstedt will give his comments and views on the first quarter and the market situation. Please, Martin.
Thank you, Erik. And also from my side, warm welcome to this quarter one reporting for 2014. It doesn't matter how many times you see this film, you're always getting a little tear in the eye, as Jan said. But maybe it's part of our culture. Warm welcome to this very interesting quarter again. Of course, it has been to a big extent focused on the full transition of Euro 6 in Europe. What will happen with the demand after the pre-buy of Euro 5? But what we saw was a pretty short pre-buy of Euro 5, but how big should the trough be? And I can say that the signs are better than expected, both when it comes to the general economic situation in Europe, but also for the specific position of Scania with a continuous gain in market share also this quarter. And I will come back to that in more detail in a couple of minutes here. Also, when it comes to the cost situation, a more stable production pace in the European system during quarter one was important for us. We had last year a high level of volatility, different type of rates. So we see that some leverage is coming through when it comes to capacity utilization, productivity, both in our internal value chain, but also when it comes to our supply value chain and the transport. Also, purchasing activities are paying off in a good pace, and Jan will come back to that. We also maintain a good flexibility in the European and in the Latin American production system to cope with both up and downturns depending on the market development. Demand in the first quarter has also been stable if you compare to the two previous quarters in Latin America. But we see that signs of a slowdown are more visible now. The lack of the simplified process when it comes to credit approval, of course, had increased the lead times. And this simplified process has finally been reinstalled again as 1st of April, and we need to follow the effects of that. And also what that means in relation to the general economic development in Latin America. So what we do in Latin America is that we have a high flexibility, as I said, when it comes to manning. But also, and I think that is important to state, Scania has during many years worked with a global product structure and thus also a global production system, meaning that we can move production for example, overseas market to Latin America, something that we have started to do also to actually take leverage and advantage of the weakening real. We have also seen that our offering are steadily gaining ground in important markets in or important emerging markets such as Russia, South Africa, Southeast Asia, and Hong Kong during the period. And the good signs of this is what we have been discussing during a number of quarters is that the more advanced logistical systems are taking on our type of solutions. And I think that is also something that we look upon now with a lot of encouragement. The revenues of service continue to develop positively during the first quarter and show a growth rate of 7% in local currencies when it comes to the volume. When it comes to the volume, it was 5%. This is very important since it is showing an increased utilization of the rolling fleet, i.e., the general economic situation, but also that we now, during a number of quarters, are seeing the signs of an increased service sales per vehicle. In addition, important emerging markets such as Russia and Brazil are continuing to grow with good pace. Also, our financial services operations posted another record year, a record quarter in earnings, and the most important findings is that the close customer relation we have is functioning really well. And that we see also when it comes to overdues and bad debt that are on historically low levels. At the minor side of the balance, we still have weaker currencies, mainly then, of course, in emerging markets, affecting profitability with approximately 345 million Swedish crown during the first quarter. If we then look into Europe more specifically, the overall situation, we have a more stable economy, meaning, and that is a very close link with the stabilization of economy and the demand for our type of solutions. Scania's main scenario is that we will continue to improve further during the year, as we have already said, but we were seeing already in the first quarter order bookings better than expected, with a less pronounced downturn after the Euro 5 pre-buy. The order intake for Europe increased 6% year on year and 44% sequentially. As I said, both a sign of continued stabilization and bottoming out of the European cycle, but also the increased replacement need of transport equipment. The big volumes shipped in 2005 to 2008 are more urgently due for replacement. In addition, Scania's strong position in the Euro 6 offering is contributing positively. This trend shows continuous good prospects for the rest of the year and also, as we can see, the years to come. Demand for used truck continues to be good, confirming a stabilization. And that is often seen as an early indicator. With a streamlined introduction during mainly third and fourth quarter last year, we have seen slightly better pricing, whereas pricing and margin effects of Euro 6 still is early to be seen, but so far it has been neutral to very slight positive effect on margins. During quarter one, still with two or three countries preliminary figures, Scania improved its market share with 0.8 percentage point to 15.5% in the European market and made important progress in markets such as Germany and France. Also in markets with an early and distinct transition already during last year of Euro 6, such as Switzerland and Austria, Scania has established a new and much higher level of market share. The market share figure for Europe gave Scania the third position in the market. Our basic scenario is that the transport industry is Europe standing in front of a period of growth. The pattern historically is supporting this scenario. Looking at periods such as the mid-90s and 2003 to 2004, when markets started to grow. The reasons are, of course, the stabilization in Europe that we have been seeing lately, a clear need of replacement of the rolling fleet in many markets and in many segments. If we have seen a recovery after the deep trough in 2009, volumes still have been on a level that we saw in between 2000 and 2005. And still, 2005 to 2008, high volumes are due for replacement. The peak in Europe, it is now only Euro 6 machines onwards, which will gradually also give a much better long-term relation between the underlying economic development and the supply. And this is important since we don't have a new legislation coming in a number of years that will disturb the picture. Therefore, we remain positive about the European truck cycle and are well prepared also when it comes to our production system and production capacity. The increased capacity that we are currently doing is done in the existing structure and thus gives good leverage between volume and capital expenditure. Also recently, some other peers in our industry gave the same view of stronger than expected demand in Europe. The order intake, our focused efforts in the Euro 6 transition with an early introduction of Euro 6 already a couple of years ago, as well as a wide range of Euro 6 engines, both for power ratings and for renewable fuels, as well as the introduction of Streamline last year with the second generation of Euro 6 engines are paying off. In March, the respected German transport trade magazines Verkehr Rundschau and Trucker gave Scania G410 their Green Truck 2014 award with an averaging record low fuel consumption of 23.3 litres of diesel per 100 kilometres, which is fantastic. The Scania G410 took first place with a wide margin in the environmental rankings on which the award is based. And I think we are standing with the Euro 6 in front of a pretty interesting positioning in the markets between the different manufacturers. In Europe, several very important orders were received during quarter one, not at least in Austria, with Noreger 220 units for biofuel, for biodiesel, Euro 6. Also in Austria for Bundesbeschaffung, 485 trucks for different applications, as well as 1,500 trucks for Stobart in the U.K., whereof approximately 50% will be shipped into the market this year. Also for Bundesbeschaffung, of course, this is concerning deliveries over a couple of years. And we are taking in orders in relation to what we will deliver over the year and not the full order as such. Order bookings in Latin America, if I can get that slide here, and mainly Brazil, continued on a level similar to quarter three and quarter four 2013, but fell year-on-year with 31%. The current package of subsidies in Brazil are valid through 2014. And as you know, the subsidized interest have moved from 4% to 6%. Between December and up to now, it has not been a simplified process of the credit approval. It's reinstalled as from 1st of April, and there we need to see the effects on that, not at least when it comes to lead time and visibility. But still, of course, there are also macroeconomic questions regarding the development in mainly Brazil and Argentina. However, if we look at the market share, we are maintaining the high level of market share that we gained during 2013, and that is, of course, thanks to the strong position in Euro 5. It's thanks to the entry of the heavy distribution segment that we have started a couple of years ago, and it's also a strong position in the agricultural sector that is functioning well in Brazil. What we can say about the Brazilian market, of course, is that it has been showing very good growth rates the last 25 years, but there is still a considerable amount of older trucks on the road, still with this development for the heavy solutions. I think also the structural shift of transport equipment to more heavy solutions will continue, as we see that the Latin American countries are approximately 15 to 20 years after when it comes to the mix between light, medium, and heavy truck solutions. So there is still a structural potential. However, the last years have also, as you know, been compounded by incentive systems, and there are reasons to believe that we will have a slowdown and a more steady development for a number of years now. But still, we believe on historically good levels. Order intake, as I said, has slowed down now recently, and the effects of the simplified process we need to follow. Scania has a good level of flexibility, both when it comes to manning, if we need to take down the production rate, but even more importantly, we can, since we have global product and production system, also move volumes from our European system, mainly for other overseas market, giving a good leverage when it comes to the currency balance. In Eurasia, the strategy of better presence in more segments continue to be successful. Order bookings were up to 2,900, which is a very, very high level, 85% higher than last year-on-year, and also even higher sequentially. In Russia, a number of bigger fleet deals were taken, and what is positive to see here is that we are taking fleet deals in all parts of the country. We took a number of bigger fleet deals in the Moscow region, 100 units to Verne, 85 to Dentro, but we also took 260 trucks to Delco in Tatarstan, and which was very, very encouraging, 60 units to Translink in Novosibirsk. That is showing also that our expansion into the eastern part, what we call the Beyond Ural strategy, is working successfully. Of course, the political turmoil makes the future uncertain, and we are closely monitoring pipeline and development. We have a good grip on the Russian market since, to a big extent, it's based on captive sales and captive services. In order to compensate for the weakening ruble, we have already and will continue to implement a number of price increases. The structural potential in the market for our type of transport equipment is, as I said, regarding Latin America, still very valid, not at least, as I also said, in the Asian part of the country. The growing service business is confirming that the network expansion is working really well, and we have implemented several more advanced service packages when it comes to repair and maintenance contracts, among other things, specially tailored for the Russian conditions with good success. In Asia, order bookings improved in the quarter and increased with more than 26% year-on-year and 19% sequentially, related mainly to rise in Middle East, but also, as I previously said, to better order intake in markets with mature logistics in Far East, such as South Korea, Malaysia, and Hong Kong. In Iran, the current window of relieved sanctions, implying the opportunity for Scania to deliver KD, knockdown kits, is open up to 20th of July. And after that, if the situation should go back to the former sanction situation, Scania can deliver complete build-up units and spare parts, but with a lower pace. However, our feedback from political context, both in Europe and the U.S., is that the development in the negotiations are interesting, and this is to be closely monitored. In the midterm, we see therefore good potential to come back to good volumes in several markets in the Middle East with a more open economy and more democracy. In Africa and Oceania, order bookings also increased somewhat more than 30% year-on-year. Sequentially, it was 18%. Scania has, during the quarter, continued to gain market share in markets such as South Africa and Australia. For buses, last year started with a number of large orders, 2013. For example, you might remember the Sochi deal for Scania of 709 buses that are now operating in the Moscow region, and also a big deal to Prasarana in Malaysia. So in comparison, quarter one, 2014 is lower, but on good levels historically. Sequentially, the improvement was 33%. During quarter one, the European market has shown improvement, but still volumes are low and price pressure is still very present. Therefore, Scania took during the quarter a decision to restructure the city bus operation to take down break-even level and to build in even more flexibility in the cost structures. The measures will create a competitive structure for this type of very volatile operation, not at least when it comes to the bus body building sector. The impact is both on blue and white-collar workers in Poland and Sweden and affects approximately 250 people. We have a good and close dialogue with our unions, our employees, and of course, society. During the quarter, Scania has received an important deal also of 300 units to Ghana, to the capital Accra, for a new BRT system that has been signed with the Ministry of Transport of Ghana in the presence of the Crown Princess of Sweden. In addition to the buses, which is interesting, we are also delivering ticketing machines, infrastructure solutions, training, service support. So it's a more and more complete solution and a very important foothold for Scania into West Africa. This deal is not yet put into the order system since we are in the specification phase. In the beginning of second quarter, Scania received also an important order of 114 buses for Norway, whereof 89 will be put into operation this year, also important for our Scandinavian operations. On the engine business area, order intake was stable year-on-year with improvements mainly in Asia, Eurasia, and Africa. For some regions, it was a weakening situation, and mainly in Europe, since we had a pre-buy of engines upfront, T4 final and Stage 4 legislations. And since we are delivering to OEMs, often that pre-buy is a little bit more pronounced. Scania was, however, during the quarter awarded, and we are very proud of that, a very prestigious contract to Atlas Copco, the Swedish OEM for compressors, gensets, mining equipment, etc. Atlas has developed a new range of portable large air compressors that will be powered by Scania's 9, 13, and 16-liter engines. This extended partnership with Atlas Copco can give volumes up to 800 units per year. For services, we had another strong quarter, actually the highest revenues ever historically, with revenues growing 7% year-on-year in local currencies and more than 5% in volumes. The service market share is increasing, and strong developments have continued to be seen in emerging markets such as Russia, Latin America, and Asia. Also, we did see a positive sign from Southern Europe finally, such as Spain and Italy, implying also better utilization of the rolling fleet in those markets. The very clear focus over the last year to support our customers with more advanced service packages, new concepts such as developed repair and maintenance contracts, and also fleet management-based services such as Ecolution by Scania is starting to pay off here. The effects have been visible during a number of quarters now that Scania's penetration per vehicle in the installed fleet is increasing. The focus of increased sales per vehicle is, of course, very important for our long-term profitability and less vulnerability for different troughs when it comes to new vehicle deliveries. As one very good example, Scania has more than 60,000 connected trucks now, and we will see almost a doubling of the number of connected trucks only during 2014. And the connectivity will continue to increase our ability to communicate with the customers over the life cycle, but also to have a good communication between the operational parts, such as service workshops and our mobile workshops. And this has shown to be a very important tool to increase sales per vehicle in services. Also, to further support the service sales, we are continuing pursuing our plans when it comes to investments in sales and service network capacity in emerging markets. Just as one example now, we did during quarter one finalize the takeover of our distributor in Kenya, and we have been forming Scania East Africa together with Tanzania, Rwanda, Burundi, Uganda, Southern Sudan, where we see also good prospects with a strong Scania position. The gains in service market share is encouraging, as I said, and we all continue to focus on those activities. So in summary, quarter has shown finally that the expected underlying improvement in Europe is started to take off. Improvements in order bookings, both year-on-year and sequentially. Less than expected trough after the Euro 5 pre-buy. We see a continued stabilization of the European economy, as we said. Replacement of the older vehicles in the fleet, 2005, 2008 peak are due for replacement. And what is Scania specific, what we are also seeing, the strong position in Euro 6, both in power ratings as well as different fuel qualities, and market share continue to develop. I think it's also very important that the financial services is showing such a low level when it comes to overdue and bad debt. Demand in Latin America, in line with two previous quarters, but we need to be cautious, have a good flexibility, use the opportunity to leverage the global product and production system Scania is having, and be very, very close to what is happening. Strong improvement order intake in Eurasia, but also there, the market situation is uncertain, and we need to monitor it. There are still room for structural changes, not at least in the Asian part. Asia, Africa, Oceania are developing positively. Service business and finance solutions are on very good levels and record high historically. Better utilization in the rolling fleet, as well as increased penetration of service sales per vehicles are the main reasons. So with that, I leave the word to our CFO, Jan Ytterberg, who will give his view on the financial figures. Thank you very much.
Okay. As Martin mentioned, as anticipated, the hangover effect after the pre-buy in Europe has been short and limited, whereas the Brazilian hangover has been longer, reflecting a long party period of subsidized financing programs pre-2014. And as a summary, and that is also reflected in the financial, we can conclude a better and more stable start of the year than expected. And it's actually easy to get lost in all the short-term challenges we have in the day-to-day business. But put in perspective, this first quarter 2014 was actually volume and invoicing-wise at record levels, as good as the start of the exceptional years 2008 and 2011. If the operation showed stability, the turbulence around the company has more been related to the shareholder situation and the public offer from Volkswagen on the remaining shares of Scania. The work that the company must do in a bid situation and the costs connected to it are intensive and substantial. So to be transparent and facilitate the analysis of the underlying operation, the cost connected to the bid, 130 million Swedish kronor, has been separated and treated as an item affecting comparability and is put in the financial net. With improved volumes of vehicle deliveries and improved volume of services, the operating income in the first quarter 2014 increased by 324 million to 2,255 million in the quarter, and that giving then an improved operating margin of 10.7%. The earnings in financial services operation has gradually improved over the last year. Once again then, in this quarter, financial services marked a new record earnings on back of improved customer solvency. And there exist good possibilities for Scania to grow in and with the market. Scania continues to invest in the future by developing new products and services, by increasing the technical production capacity, and by expanding the service network into emerging markets. So subsequently, the cost and investment level has continued to be high. During the pre-buy in the fourth quarter last year, the focus in production and of course also in logistics and the sales and service companies was to get out the vehicles in Europe and in Brazil before the year end. Consequently, deliveries to other markets had lower priorities during the fourth quarter, but have increased again here in the first quarter this year. The short pre-buy effect in Europe was also seen in the improved deliveries. They are up 20% compared to the first quarter last year. And the deliveries in Latin America were negatively affected by the pre-buy effect in Brazil, together then, of course, also with the financial turmoil around Argentina. The new subsidized program in Brazil is still beneficial, but not as exceptional as it was in 2013. And that the requirement of down payment of up to 20% for bigger customers in the new program has, together then also with slower administrative process at central bank, led to longer lead time and more difficult sales process. Sharp increase in the leverage deliveries was also seen in Asia, and that mainly related then to Middle East. To summarize the vehicle deliveries, we can say good start of the year in all markets except Latin America. In production, it has actually been the inverted world compared to last year. During first quarter last year, Latin America was running full speed ahead, whereas we had some 7 stop days in the European production due to lack of demand. This year, on the contrary, we have been running the European production at a high, stable production rate without stop days, whereas Latin America has had 17 more vacations and stop days in the quarter compared to last year. Globally, though, the production volume increased slightly over 10% compared to the first quarter 2013, but was 15% lower than the fourth quarter last year. The high activity in the market, in the truck market, affected the sale of used vehicles positively as well. In the beginning of the year, the deliveries of used vehicles increased slightly, or 10%, but increased demand of used vehicles refers mainly to Europe and, in combination with an improved pricing environment for used vehicles, supports the signs of an improved vehicle demand going forward. As was mentioned by Martin, best quarter ever in the first quarter 2014 as regard volume and as regard revenues. And that is very rewarding for the organization to get a receipt on the focused work that we have been doing the last 3 to 5 years to increase the service volumes. And it's also encouraging for the journey towards the target for year 2020 of service revenues representing 25%-30% of total net sales. As the service is more profitable and stable than the vehicle operation, the expansion of the service business is important both as a cushion for the volatility in the vehicle demand, but also as one cornerstone to get profitability back to historical levels. For Scania, it has been important that it has been a pronounced increase of services and the service demand in Europe of both parts and workshop hours, as Europe stands for around 70% of our total service revenues. Behind this development is, on the European side, an increasing average of the transport capacity, and then on the emerging market side, an increasing rolling fleet after high vehicle deliveries the last years. That has partly been offset then by a good and improving product quality, which means that the warranty costs are at low levels presently. And the increased service demand can be described and was reflected in the increased number of sold hours. They were up 6% compared to the first quarter last year, or  120,000 hours. All in all, in the quarter, we sold 2.2 million hours. And prices increases somewhat and impacted positively as well for service revenues and the margins. So all in all, as Martin has mentioned, 7% up in local currencies, but as a consequence of a weaker emerging market currencies, the increase of service revenues were limited to 6% and passed 4.5 billion in the quarter. Due to high deliveries and high service volume, the total net sales increased by 9% compared to the first quarter last year. The impact from the higher volumes was partly offset then by weaker currencies in some of our important emerging market currencies, and that impacted net sales negatively with 2%. Subsequently, in local currencies, net sales up 13%. The high deliveries and service volume were also decisive behind the ability for us to sequentially maintain the improving trend of the operating margin. The margin was 10.7% in this quarter. Operating income improved 324 million, up then to 2,257 million. And as I mentioned, financial net then included the cost for the Volkswagen public offer of 130 million, classified as an item affecting comparability. If we exclude that one, financial net was stable between the years. Tax rate, 26% for the quarter, negatively affected then by a high share of the result being generated in Brazil, where the tax rate is 34%. So net income, and net income then included this 130 million, was 1,557 million, giving a net margin of 7.4% and an earnings per share of 1.95 Swedish krona. The reason behind this improvement of 324 million is then mainly related to the operating income in the vehicles and services, and we will take a look on some of the explanations. The one most important factor, of course, vehicle deliveries up 1,900 units and service volume up as well. And as a consequence of a high and stable production level in Europe, the capacity utilization improved compared to last year. Last year, the cost per unit was high due to volatility. We were changing the production pace several times during the year, and also in the first quarter, negatively affected by some 7 stop days in the European production. In Brazil, however, cost per unit was negatively affected this year by 17 more vacation days or stop days. Globally, though, if we add this together, capacity utilization impacted positively compared to the first quarter last year. Vehicle prices impacted also slightly positively, and we can see 3 things explaining that: the introduction of Streamline, the improved prices in Russia to compensate ourselves for the utilization fee, and also price increases in emerging countries to compensate ourselves for the weaker local currency. And when we talk about prices, we should not only talk about the prices out to the customer, but also the prices in. The focus and successful work at purchasing over some 12 to 18 months now to decrease material cost per vehicle. Was clearly seen here in the first quarter, partly then related to the synergy work together with Volkswagen and MAN. On the negative side, we continued to have headwind from currencies in the beginning of 2014. The negative currency effect was 345 million compared to the first quarter last year, and the effect was high due to a much weaker Brazilian real. We are once again talking about the devaluation of 15% compared to the first quarter last year, and I think it was more or less the same during the whole last year. That, of course, in combination with the considerable net inflow still of Brazilian real, impacted very negatively for us. And of course, also the Russian ruble, that was in average 12% weaker in the first quarter than last year, and also other important net inflow currencies for us, such as the South African rand, Australian dollar, the Norwegian krona, etc. Those impacted negatively as well, but this was to some extent offset by a stronger euro and a stronger pound sterling that had a positive impact. So it's quite encouraging now when we see that the euro is coming back, that we have better and better inflow of euro, and we had actually a quite substantial net inflow in the first quarter, which was a trend shift from what we experienced last year. Market mix did also impact negatively as a consequence of lower volumes in Brazil and Latin America and higher volumes into Middle East and Eurasia, where specification level is lower. And there exist good possibilities for Scania to grow in and with the market, and we have continued to invest, as I said, into future products and services, into increased technical production capacity and expansion on the service side into emerging market. So cost and investment level continue to be high. First quarter of the year is normally a weak quarter from a cash generation perspective, as certain build-up of inventory is taking place after the end of a seasonally strong fourth quarter delivery-wise. And this year was no exception to that rule. So the cash flow in vehicles and service segment was quite limited. It was limited to 730 million. The effect from the increasing inventory impacted then working capital negatively. And when I talk about inventory, it's mainly then new vehicles. And the high ambition in the company affected also net investments negatively. It was close to 1.4 billion of net investment, where 350 million was related to capitalized R&D expenses. And we also had an acquisition of assets and an asset transfer to acquire the Kenyan distributor that impacted the cash flow in the quarter. So performance on financial services operation is a bright and promising spot in this first quarterly report for the year. Credit portfolio remained rather unchanged and increased by 0.6 billion or 1% since year end in local currencies. Finance penetration increased 35% to 35% from 30% as a consequence of a higher penetration in Brazil, where our financial services operation still is in an expansion phase after being operative some 3 to 4 years now. The finance penetration in Brazil is still, though, under the group average. Financial situation for our customer is in general good, and we see good payment performance from our customers. As a consequence, the overdue receivables as a percentage of the portfolio have continued to be at historically very low levels, and bad debt expenses were actually approaching zero in the quarter. And that is mainly related to an improvement in Southern Europe, where we had bad debt expenses last year, but we are not having so much in this year. Operating income for the first quarter 2014, 266 million, an increase of over 110 million compared to last year. Three reasons: higher average portfolio compared to last year, better margins in the portfolio, and lower bad debt expenses. So, summing up, earnings improved due to high vehicle deliveries and high service volumes, whereas certain emerging market currencies weakened and impacted negatively. Scania has continued to invest in the future, and subsequently we have continued to have a high cost and high investment level. And the operating margin improved sequentially and compared to the first quarter last year. several promising signs in the demand pattern and in the performance of Scania were noticed. The service volume and revenues were at record high levels. Financial services continue to show record quarterly earnings, partly then as a consequence of good financial situation among our customers. What is lacking now among our customers is some confidence about an improved future economic development before our customers are prepared to unleash their demand. Used vehicle pricing and volume are picking up in Europe, and we saw a shorter pre-buy than feared or expected in Europe. To handle then the decreased demand in Brazil is of course a challenge for us, but with our global product, with our global production system, this creates also possibilities for us to leverage a good cost situation in Brazil due to the weak real now as demand improves outside Latin America. So in general, a good start of the year and some well-deserved tailwind for the future and for the organization. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. Thank you, Martin. Time for question and answer session. As usual, we have microphones for you, and I see some hands all ready. The first question comes from Hampus Engelau.
Thank you very much. I have three questions. First question is related to your comments on Europe, and if you maybe you have reduced run rate, you're taking out some temporary workforce, and I was wondering how does that correspond to what you're seeing now in Europe in terms of run rate and how you see that developing. Second question is on Russia, very good order intake. What risk do you see? I mean, you highlighted the risk, of course, but maybe if you could talk a little bit about that, and what risk do you see that those orders might not materialize in terms of sales, etc. And then finally, on Brazil, how much do you see the longer lead time to get the tsunami as a negative impact on orders and maybe corresponding to what underlying demand you're seeing? Thanks.
Can I start? If we start then, Hampus, with Europe, as we said, we took down approximately 5% around year end. And what has been good for us is that we, after that, has been very well balanced between the real demand and supply, and we have not, in any material sense, built up an extended order book to a little bit, maybe 1 week. The good part of that is that now, when still demand is continuing to improve, because we've had a sequential improvement also in the quarter, is that we are, as Jan also was into, been starting to move some of the production into Latin American system. Because what we see now, the better we can continue with a certain pace, the more also we can leverage when it comes to productivity, supply chain, transport, which is very important to us. So I would say, except from the normal measures we're doing, because if we have X, we are always hovering around X plus minus a couple of percent with our normal flexibility systems, with overtime, with flexible working hours, etc. We will actually rather move some of the overseas markets into Latin American system. Also, thanks to the cost situation with the weakening real. So I think we are stable, we are hovering, we're using the flexible work hours, we are keeping the eye on keeping order book short, as we have discussed. I remember last quarterly reporting, we had a discussion, what is the cost for that, etc. I think the cost has been a little bit higher than expected. That's the reason why we want to keep it a little bit longer stable and use actually the global landscape. Russia, as always, of course, you should be very cautious with the political turmoil, and we saw that in 2008-2009. At the same time, when it comes to these type of orders, and as I said, we have had the big volumes through our captive networks, down payments, etc. I think the orders as such are... I will not call it safe, because then I think you will not believe me anyhow. But I think they are pretty solid, short lead times. It's more about order intake going forward, of course, that we have seen that there is a reluctance. But still, with the very high level we had in quarter one, you should anyhow not expect that to continue. Because we normally said the Russian market is a little bit like bus market, that you can get in some very big orders. But we are closely monitoring that, keeping short lead times, as we said. And then finally, I don't know if you also want to say, but it's always different aspects when it comes to Brazil. And we know also the psychological effect in Brazil when things are changing, and especially to the better. However, we believe that there have been a very strong growth over a couple of years now, and that cannot pursue forever, and that is what also what we have said. So we think, of course, 2014 in deliveries will be weaker, but still on historically good levels. And again, what we would like to say there, of course, incentive and financing system, but also once the structural move has started into more heavy transport, that will continue. And I think it's interesting, we have more and more started to measure that type of movement when it comes to the mix between light, medium and heavy. And still, as I said, Brazil is on 1990 level in Europe, and there are still a lot of room for improvement. But it will be a weaker year, even though that in short term now, of course, it will be like an order book effect with a shorter, simplified process that we can push through a number of orders here.
No, I think what you mentioned is also part of the strategy, because the strategy we have to was to push emerging markets and concentrate on Europe in Europe. And then we expected, hoped that the order would come back, demand would come back in Europe, so that we could balance the system rather high, which we did in Europe. That strategy worked, so that is good. And now we see that the European is filling up the production slots, which is very important for us. And of course, also in Russia, you have the situation, and we have had it for a while, that of course in ruble, these vehicles are getting more and more expensive all the time. So I mean, that is also an effect behind the high order intake and deliveries in the first quarter. Well, otherwise, I'm rather surprised personally, since being in Brazil, that we don't see more of an election effect or a football World Cup or something, but we are not. So this is something we have really to watch out for right now, because, as we have said, long party, difficult hangover, and they have been having a long party in Brazil now with the subsidized financing.
Okay, we have a new question from
Erik Olrang, ABG Sundal Collier. I have two questions. The first one's on profitability. You highlight the positives there, quite a few of them. Higher utilization rates. I think you talked about positive pricing as well. Production up quite a bit and deliveries with them. Good service sales. And still the gross margin drops year on year again. We know about FX, and then you talk about mix. How big are the mix, the profitability differences now on a regional basis? I would have thought that Brazil would have come down given the weak currency and so on, but you're still saying that it's a pretty pronounced mix effect.
What I'm saying was that we are suffering from that Latin America are being substituted with Middle East and Russia, so with lower specification level than the ones we are having in Latin America. That is the comment I'm making.
So the market mix is also specification level mix, implying that because you have a different type of trucks coming into Middle East and in Africa than in Latin America, more advanced logistics. Yeah.
Then, of course, you're right. What has happened is that we are not in 2010 now, so the margin per vehicle has been going down gradually. Our problem is not only the currency of selling in real, it's also that we are importing Swedish krona and euro, as around one third of the material kit is being imported into Brazil. So that is, of course, hurting our profitability per vehicle in Brazil. Positive, of course, Europe is going up as a percentage of the total, since we are up with 20% in deliveries in Europe. And there we have top class margin per vehicle.
But I think also one important factor, John was into it a little bit, is also on the cost development. I mean, when you think year on year, and we had very high ambitions, and we still have high ambitions in the company when it comes to investment levels, different type of initiatives, etc. But as we have said, both in quarter four and quarter three reportings, we are also working with priorities in the company. And when you look year on year, of course, it is still a higher level. But when you look sequentially, we are coming through now also with that the priorities on the cost structure is giving effect.
So there should be a turning point year on year at some point during this year?
Yes.
Yes.
Then the second question, a follow-up on Brazil here. You talk about stable demand compared to recent quarters, but it's down by a third year on year, so it must have slowed down at some point, I guess. Yeah. What's, assuming that we gradually move out of these subsidies, is How big of an impact do you think that could have on the total market? And if that would happen, that you gradually get lower levels of subsidies, do you think you could lose market share, as I guess the upfront cost would be relatively higher than for a Scania truck than some others?
If you start with the cycle as such, you should also remember that quarter four 2012 and quarter one 2013 was extremely high when it comes to order intake, also because then it had been, you know, a trough after it was a wait and see mood in quarter two and quarter three 2012. So I think we are also comparing a quarter last year that was extremely high when it comes to order intake, not in deliveries, because we couldn't cope with it, none of us in the industry. Nevertheless, you're right. It is a lower demand now. But what I think we should see is that it was not sustainable over time, anyhow. We knew it. We profit from it during that time. But the structural situation in Brazil is still there. It will be growth. It will be more mature logistics. And mature logistics is implying, of course, more advanced solutions into the heavy sector. The good part is also legislation in Brazil is driving towards more heavy equipment. Which is also good both for the agri but also for long haul sector. And again, also I think what we have seen in the heavy distribution segment that we entered a couple of years ago now is just the start for Scania actually. So there are of course macroeconomic wise uncertainty. We need to be very close to that, work with the pipeline. But as we also said, we have a global product and production system that we can use. To see that it will continue to grow and the high levels that we've seen in recent years is unrealistic, and that we have already been put into the plans and forecast. Then when it comes to the financing and subsidies as such, I think rather on the opposite. We see mileage coming up. We see more opportunities for heavy solutions with the legislations. Fuel prices will not deteriorate, they will continue to increase, etc. Euro 5 machines are making medium and heavy trucks more close when it comes to pricing, because the Euro 5 technology is equally expensive if you have a medium truck than you have a heavy truck, etc. But then, and then of course, a total life cycle perspective that you see in more mature logistics market. And Brazil is today down to 13%, I think, of GDP in logistics, which is a pretty good. But they, of course, want to go down to the European 8-9%.
If we take a look on page 38, we have here Per, if we can get that, which is the change of the different segments in Brazil. We would see that curve is to a very big extent also an inverted curve of the market. So it's not only the GDP as such, it's also this shift we see in our own rather impressive total registrations and sales of our heavy vehicles, which you had in the presentation of Martin, which you were referring to also here. Mm.
No, but that is, I think, this is what we showed at the Capital Markets Day. And here you see where they are now, 2012 here, is where Europe were 1990.
Very good. Do we have any more questions? I see no hands. Then we conclude Scania's press and web conference. And thank you for joining us today, and we wish you a pleasant day.